Hey guys, my name is Pranav. I'll be your host for today. And welcome to the second day of Divergence, the event where we help you figure out your interests and the path that you will want to take on your engineering journey. Right. So on day one, we had IoT and web development. I saw a lot of you guys here had joined for that session. Now we hope you gain lots of useful insight from that session. And now we're kicking off the second day with a session on entrepreneurship. So we'll be having with us today Mohammad Razin, who is the Chief Marketing Officer of IDC MEC, the ex-chairperson at Hack Club MEC. Also, his project Lifeboat is currently under pre-incubation with IDC. He's going to be talking to you today, so without wasting any more time, over to him.
Okay, guys, as Pranav introduced, I am Mohammad Razin, and I'll be taking the session today. I hope not to bore you guys to death. So let's get started, shall we? I'm this guy in the screen. I'm Razin Mohammed. So I'll be talking about the thing that Elon Musk and Ratan Tata does, or entrepreneurship. So I'll just go through the stuff that we're going to cover. We'll go through something called the ideal life of an engineer, the so-called ideal life of an engineer. Then we'll talk about a few key ingredients of ingredients in entrepreneurship, just the basic stuff. And I'll tell you why I feel that you, each and every one of you, should explore it. And then after that, we'll create a business together right here, right now. And then I'll give you a few more resources on how to expand your knowledge from based on what we start right here. All right. So the ideal life of an engineer, or the life that the so-called ideal life of an engineer, or the life that your parents expected you to have when they sent you there. Okay. First, they sent you to a good college. And in my opinion, MEC is a pretty awesome college. And they expect you to have pretty good scores, then secure a nice internship to boost your skills, then leverage your scores and your internship to get pretty good placements or safe and secure jobs. And then get married, have kids, which is something they're going to push down your throats. And the last one is getting promoted, and the last one continuing as a SIP. And so the reason I told you this is I want you guys to have this picture in your mind till the end of the session, because in the end of the session, I'm going to pull the screen up again and I'm going to add one more last thing to it. Okay. So just keep this in your mind. Now let's go on to our actual session. So I'll be talking about entrepreneurship, and it is something that pretty much all of you know the basics of. You know what entrepreneurship is, and you know about startups. You've all heard about startups. So I want you to do me a favor. Just drop the names of the first two or three startups that comes to your mind when you think about startups. Just drop any name, any startup names that comes to your mind. Drop it here now. Keep dropping these names right now, and we'll get back to that soon. Okay. Again, I know this is the second thing I'm asking you to do, and telling you that I'll get back to it soon, but this is probably the last one. Okay. Now we'll go on to the key elements. As I mentioned, we'll talk about some key ingredients in entrepreneurship, right? So there are three key elements that I want you to remember. Okay. First one is solve a need or want, or solve a problem. Okay. Solve a problem. Problem does not necessarily be something that is necessary for the people. It can be something along the lines of a luxury. Okay. Something that is not exactly necessary. Just something that is a want, not a need. Okay. So solve a need or want. Second one is create an opportunity. Create opportunities. And the third one is something that I'll ask you guys to guess while we get there. Going a bit deeper into it. So solving a need or want, or solving a problem, basically consists of a couple of aspects. The first thing is market research. I'll just talk about it. So you need to know who needs or wants the solution. Who are the people who find this requirement? Okay. Then why does that need exist? And how long will it actually exist for? Because if it's a need that's only going to exist for a couple of months, then you probably cannot build a long-term business out of it, right? Then is the number of people who need it actually increasing, or is it stagnant? Because if the number of people is actually stagnant, and if the same number is continuing every year, you can have a stable business, but you cannot have an increasing business. So that's just something you can keep in mind. And we'll take the example of Twitch. So yes, Twitch provides video streaming, right? So when they actually introduced their application, now I'm just going to say a small story about Twitch, okay? When they first introduced their application or their web-based application, they were planning to make the features feasible for any user. Anyone who wanted to video stream, live stream, anything, they could utilize Twitch. Okay. So back then the company was called Justin TV. Then they saw a really less number of increase in the users and usages. And in the beginning, the only user was the co-founder Justin himself. And then later on, they saw something. A lot of gamers were actually really, the number of people who were using Twitch, most of them were actually gamers. And they were using it to live stream their game. Okay, live stream them playing the game. Okay, so by then they realized that they should probably be concentrating more on the gamers and their live streaming features. Okay, then they started talking more to the gamers and realized what exact features do the gamers expect from them. And they doubled down on that and created the created a platform that is most apt for gamers. Okay, that's how Twitch finally became what it is today. So that is what they did. That what the this process that they followed is known as market research. Or they realized that the people who need or want their product the most are gamers. And they doubled down on that. They made their platform as best as possible for them. And obviously, we know the last point is the number of people increasing who need it increasing, or is it stagnant? We know that the number of gamers are increasing at a really high rate. So that was a pretty good market for them. So I hope you guys get a picture of what market research actually is. Wait a second. And the next thing is competitor analysis. And the last thing is unique selling point. Competitor analysis is pretty self-explanatory. That is, you just need to know whether there is an existing solution already. And if anybody is providing an existing solution, what are their fallbacks? What could they become better at? And what should you become better at to beat them in the market? Okay. So the final thing that I just mentioned, that is what could you do extra that could beat them, beat the rest of them in the market? That is called unique selling point. And that too, Twitch increase their features that are apt for gamers, which improve the increase the amount of gamers coming into their platform. Thereby, that was their USP or unique selling point. More features apt for gamers. Okay. So back then, their competitors were apps like the Facebook Live was their competitor. Vimeo was their competitor. Vimeo, I guess you guys would have seen the advertisement of Vimeo in YouTube. So yeah, so basically solving a need or want, or the first key element includes a couple of things. First thing is you need to have, you need to identify a problem. Then you need to do complete research on the problem. And then you need to finalize a solution. Then you need to analyze the competitors available, have a complete research on them. Create a USP which you believe could help you hit the market better than your competitors. Okay, so yeah. So I've been talking for a while now, so I'm guessing you guys might start getting bored. So I'll ask you a couple of, let's do an exercise, all right? I'll note down the names of some logos of some companies right here. I need you guys to tell me whether it's a need or a want. Okay, whether these companies are need or necessity based or want luxury based. Okay, so let's start. Okay, first one, obviously, Swiggy. Need or want? Just send your answer. Need or want? Swiggy need. Okay. Next. Need. Okay. Nice. Want. Okay. Swiggy want. Okay. Nice. Okay. A lot of mixed answers. Nice. Okay. I'm personally a person who feels that, I personally feel that this Swiggy is actually a want-based company. But then again, as I said, it's totally up to our opinion. So generally, in most cases, it can be categorized as a want, because it's basically what they do is they connect us to the nearby restaurants, and then they provide you with the they'll deliver the food that's available there as per your requirement. So most of the people that they're serving is actually serving out of luxury concept. Okay, it's want. I don't need to have a better way to easily get food from the restaurant. I could go there, it's kind of a luxury to have it in the tip of my finger. Okay. But at the same time, in some cases, for example, since COVID and all came in, having such a facility can be categorized as a need. Okay. So yeah, it's kind of a mixed opinion one, but it's really, I guess both the answers would go. Okay. So next one is not exactly an existing company, but I'll tell you what they do and I want you to tell me whether or not it would be a need or want. Okay. Let's assume there is a certain company that provides a mobile application for for people with mental health struggles, such that the people with mental health struggles, they can add in, answer a couple of questions that is asked in the application. And the application identifies what kind of mental health expert would be useful for the user. And they'll suggest the list of mental health experts. And then the user can book therapy sessions online or offline and also chat with the chat with the therapist. So do you think such a facility is a need or a want? It is basically mental health related, providing a solution to mental health. Okay, I'll come to that. Wait, Aditya has probably, you know about this. Okay, it's a need, okay. Many of you guys think it's a need indeed. Okay, all of you guys think it's a need. Okay, nice. Okay, cool. So yeah, I personally do feel it's a need as well. And that is the major reason why me and my friends, we have started building this product and it's called Lifeboat. This is the thing that Pranav actually talked to you right in the beginning, like the project lead of Lifeboat project that is pre-incubated under IDCMEC right now. So thank you guys. And thanks for an opportunity for free marketing. Okay, our last one, McDonald's. Just mention want or need. After that, I'll say something. McDonald's, need or want? Want. Okay. Want. I need Tarot needs it. Okay, nice. Okay, cool. So I just need you guys to assess one aspect. When the initial founders of McDonald's actually founded it, they had two targets in their mind. Okay. One, people were too busy and they wanted to provide a solution that would save their time. And their target was like this. When a person comes into the counter to buy a McDonald's burger, within 45 seconds or 30 seconds, I guess, if he orders a burger, within that time, less than 1 minute, there has to be a burger in his hand or an entire meal in his hand. And that was target number one. Target number two was he should be able to fill his stomach with less than $5. Okay, with less than $5, he or she should be able to fill his stomach and simultaneously saving his time. So my question is, saving time and saving money, is that need or want? Just forget about McDonald's. Saving time and saving money, is that need or want? At this point, everybody switched to need, right? For me, need. Okay, nice. Okay, cool. So this is kind of a little dilemma with respect to McDonald's, but right now, as of now, McDonald's is not exactly a need-based company. It's a want-based company. Once they started getting brand value, they raised the cost, etc. So yeah, but currently when they began, we could argue that they were a need-based company. So I guess you guys get that concept clearly, right? I'll just take one random example from the chat box. We won't explain anymore. We'll just, this is the reason I asked you guys to put in the names of companies in the beginning. Let's pick Paytm Oyo on Academy. Okay. Let's start with Paytm. Paytm need or want? Come on, shoot. And everybody just keep your chat box open and see what other people think. Okay. Paytm need or want? In case any of you does not know, Paytm is a payment platform, right? They started out as a payment platform. Need, want, okay, mixed opinion, want, okay. Interesting, I personally think it is currently a want. But in due time, it might change into a need. Such services might change into a need when our lifestyle entirely changes to that direction. So what else? Which was the next company? Oyo Rooms, need or want? Oyo Rooms, need or want? Want. That's pretty much obvious to a lot of us, no? I'm guessing nobody is going to say need. And what was the last one? An academy. Cheap education. Is that need or want? Cheap, good quality education. Come on. This is highly arguable, no? Because I personally feel cheap quality education is actually a need-based direction, because education and healthcare should probably be the most focused one in a society. So yeah. Need, want, mixed opinion. I personally feel it's a need, but okay, nice. Okay, cool. Then let's move on to the next aspect. This is the reason I actually asked you guys to send the starter names in the beginning. Okay, so now we have talked about solving a need or want or solving a problem. Now the second aspect with respect to startups is creating opportunity. So I guess the best way to actually explain it would be a simple story. Okay. Yeah. When I was about 16, I guess, when I first got into my 11th grade, I was already exposed to the field of coding and I was really interested in programming back then. Although I knew only basic Java coding, I liked the problem solving aspect of it. So I was talking to a certain person and the person was a retired businessman. He was no longer doing the business. And I was talking to a certain person about my interest in wanting to get into Google, because once you start learning coding, the next thing, next target you keep is wanting to go and work in Google. So I was talking to him about that, and he asked me a lot about it. And by the end, he told me one thing. If you can actually go to a company that in which about 1,000 people compete to get in and just one person get in, and still if you make it inside, that is so amazing. That is really nice. And then he said one more thing. And at the same time, if you're capable and if you actually, instead of going for a job that only 1 in 1,000 get, if you're able to employ or give jobs to 10 or at least 10 or 20 or 30 or even as high as 100, that's much better. Even employing 10 people is, in his opinion, much better than getting into a job that employs about 1 in every 1,000 people who tries. Okay. And this is what he said in return about why he feels so. On one hand, you're getting to a position where you're able to feed and take care of your family really, really well. Okay. On the other hand, you're providing an opportunity to 10, 20, 30, or even 100 people to feed and take care of your their families well. Okay. So this is what he actually told me. And ever since then, I had it in my mind that at some point in my life, I'll try venturing into building a company, building opportunity, et cetera, et cetera. So that is the first aspect of, first thing that comes under creating opportunity is creating new jobs. As I just mentioned, I believe that's pretty clear to you. And let's say, and by the way, this person that I talked to, let's call him ABC for now, okay? Person ABC. Then the second thing is, in many companies, that there are many companies, innovations that come up where they bring an entirely new technology, entirely new utilization for technology that will prompt other companies to build the same technology that which thereby improves again job opportunities in multiple companies. Okay, so that is again giving rise to newer markets, larger markets. So yeah, that is basically the concept of creating opportunity. And to give you a simple idea, Entry app actually started only about 2017, I guess. And currently they employ 167 people. That is, they are the source of income and stability for 167 families. And in case of Reddit, about 700 employees they have right now. And yeah, I guess I don't have to go much deeper into it. Okay, so the third thing, we talked about solving a problem, want or a need. We talked about, creating opportunities. And the third one is probably the most easy one of the first thing that comes to your mind when you think about entrepreneurship or think about a person who has multiple companies, etc., etc. What could that be? Don't think there is a right answer. Just off the top of your head, what do you think? When you think about an entrepreneur, when you think about a businessman. Exactly. Yeah. Money. Yes. Affordability. Okay, cool. Money. Yeah. This is exactly what I was going to get to. Making money. So now we have learned three things, right? First thing, the three key elements in entrepreneurship, solving a need or want, creating opportunities, and obviously making money. Okay. So when I say obviously, don't take it that this is the most important aspect. It is not. In my opinion, solving the need or want is the actually most important aspect, because that is the one that you're going to get more satisfaction out of, more, what do you say, happiness in seeing that actually working out. So happiness wise, I believe the first one and the second one is probably the most important. And what do you say? Okay, so next question, but why exactly should I get into it? Even if you just learned about the aspects in entrepreneurship, the next question, why should I get into it? So the first thing, these two are from the society aspect and the next two are from personal aspects. So first one is pretty obvious to a lot of us. Tons of problems are still waiting to be solved. And now that we talked about many of the startups, if you think about it, most of the startups that exist right now are want-based or luxury provision-based or something that solves a problem for people who can actually survive without the solution. Okay. There are still a ton of necessary need-related problems still waiting to be solved that requires the attention of every single creative people on earth right now, which includes every single one in this meeting right now, which is the reason I'm trying to convince you through these slides to explore entrepreneurship at some point, which I'll get to in the end. So tons of problems waiting to be solved. Second one, lack of jobs. And that is pretty self-explanatory. And just to give you an idea, at least 5.46 million, that is, 54 lakh Indian jobs were lost in last October. And over 4 crore people are currently unemployed more than 4 crore, because this is a statistics by 2020. Yeah, so thinking from a personal gains perspective, again, in my opinion, you can actually be an entrepreneur by just doing what you love and solving the problems you hate. Okay, that's more than enough motivation to actually venture out and create a successful company. Because remember the person ABC that I told about, what he actually had, the business he actually had was a really successful hotel restaurant in Chennai. And the reason he actually started the restaurant was because when he was there, he was working in another hotel that his relative owned. It was hard to find cheap and affordable food that with high quality in that area. Okay. So once he felt like he was capable of running a business, he started a business, he started a restaurant that solves that exact same problem. Like there is something I think that you guys might find interesting. The way he priced his products was that first thing he would think would be when the my food should be priced in such a way and the food, expense for the food should be in such a way that if a guy comes in to have food, he should be able to have his food and one drink for the total cost of 100 rupees. So he used to calculate, let's say if a person buys around 3 parotas, such and such curry and such drink, like mostly some lime juice or tea, the total amount should be 100 rupees. Then he would split that cost to find out which product can be valued at what amount. So that is how he used to price it. Again, solving the same problem that McDonald's used to solve, but in a much smaller scale, but still he ran a really successful business. So that is what he did. He just solved a problem that he found as a bad problem, and he did what he loved and ran a successful business. So second thing, next thing that you can notice, flexibility in life. That is basically you don't have to, you don't have to ask someone else permission to take leave or anything. And leaves are pretty much out of the question. You could easily manage it yourself. And the time you spend to work, etc. You could actually work in weekends if you want to and go out in weekdays, etc. So flexibility in life is pretty evident to a lot of us. And the last thing is income dependence. That is, if you're working in someone else's company, the amount of income you get highly depends on the decision the person above makes. So any wrong decision made by the person above actually highly impacts your stability in life. Okay. So stability majorly because of financial stability. Okay. So I know these are pretty, obvious stuff, but I just went a bit deeper into it in case if there's anyone who did not really grasp it entirely well. Okay. Nice. Okay, cool. So let's move on to the next aspect. Again, for a while I've been talking a lot, so we'll move on to something that you guys can work on. I'll give you a problem and we'll create a business based on that problem right here, right now. Okay. So again, chats, please open up your chats. I'll mention the problem right now. So the problem is, I don't know if any of you guys have felt it. So I'll just say the problem and you guys can mention yes or no, whether or not you have felt that problem. Okay. Last time I went into a restaurant, the restaurant was Brindavan restaurant, and I had ordered something and I forgot to order a second thing. That was a drink. I always buy chai along with whatever I ordered. So almost always buy chai. So I forgot to order that. And with my food right in front of me, I was turning back and raising my hands over and over again, expecting at least one waiter to notice me. And it took over 2 minutes. I don't know why it took so long. It took over 2 minutes for the person to notice me. It's not their fault either, because they are continually serving multiple people at the same time. So it's hard to call a waiter in a busy restaurant without making it awkward. This was the issue. This is the simple problem. I wanted to just pick an easy problem. So is there anyone else who has faced this issue? The sheer number of yeses we have in the chat alone is market validation that this problem actually exists. So now that we have the problem defined, let's create a solution. Just send random solutions that you think might work out to solve this problem. Simple thing is, I need to call the waiter without the awkwardness. Like, I need to communicate with the waiter without the rest of the people having to see it. Okay. If a table or a section is assigned to a waiter, we can have a device which pages the waiter in charge. Okay, beautiful, nice. Create a bell or a buzzer, something like that. Nice, amazing. Bell, okay, nice. Anything else, any other suggestions? Normalize calling waiters awkwardly. Okay, I totally support that though. I do support that. Okay, cool. But we can, you guys should actually hope that calling waiters awkwardly is not normalized, because otherwise we cannot make a business out of this. So what else? Okay, cool. So this is the, in my opinion, these some device which send the messages to waiters. Okay, cool. So almost all of you came up with the highly similar, almost obvious answer, and it is pretty good answer in my opinion. So every table or section is, in most cases, like 5 or 6 tables will be assigned to one waiter. So we could set up there could be two ways. Either we could set up a pager and set up a device, like a small device, small box on every single table. I'm not giving you the answer. I'm just clarifying your own answers. Okay. We could set up a small box on every table, and the box can have two buttons, simple, a green and a red button. And let's say if the person clicks the green button, it calls the waiter. It just sends two messages. Waiter is needed in such and such table. Okay. Table number XYZ. And the waiter will be called to that certain table. Okay. So either we could connect it with the mobile application, or we could connect it with the pager. If you are connecting with the pager, it becomes more expensive. Instead, if we have a, let's say, in most cases, waiters will be mostly standing in one single place. Like, there will be a waiter stall in many hotels, from my experience with talking to hotel people. So restaurant in charges. So around there, we could set up a simple mobile application that shows in which table waiter is required, and they could just ask the waiter to go there. So this is a pretty simple solution to create. So now that we have a possible solution with us, enables you to add a new thing after you have directly ordered. Okay, device which enables a second solution that Anu has suggested is a device like mobile or a tablet on every device, every table, that allows you to order directly with the add an order directly. And okay, let's analyze both of these solutions. Okay, so solution A is setting up a small box with two buttons. Solution B is setting up a whole mobile phone there. Okay, mobile phone kind of setup in every table. Okay. So then the next one, let's go to market analysis to see which one will be more feasible. And okay, first one, I need each of you to send in your chat box. Who do you think our customers are? Our customers. Who will be we selling this product to? Hotel owners, restaurant owners. Okay, cool. Now I have one more question for you. Do we actually sell to all hotel owners? Like, there are lower class hotels, there are middle class hotels, upper middle class hotels, and higher class hotels. So let's say, in my opinion, like hotels, like if you guys are in Kochi, hotel like Bindavan would come in middle class hotels. That's the one ones that most of us go to. And middle class hotels, lower class hotels, and higher class hotels. Which do you think, let's say higher class hotels are hotels like Marriott. Which do you think we'll be selling to? Which do you think will be our confirmed customer, almost confirmed customer? Busy hotels, middle class hotel, and below. Okay, only to middle class, only to middle class popular hotels. Okay, nice. So again, now we found out that our target market is not exactly entirely restaurants, only middle class restaurants and possibly higher class restaurants. And in my opinion, we might actually have to talk to higher class restaurants to know if they'd be interested in something like this. In case of middle class restaurants, they'd be really interested, I believe. And I've actually talked to about three people who are relating to this, and they seem to be interested, but they said kind of like, bring the product, we'll see, and then talk about it. Okay. So yeah, so now we did, the thing that we did right now is called market segmentation. We segmented the market into three parts and we chose one market that we'll be initially going into. Okay. So popular hotels, busy hotels, okay, nice. And again, the next question in market analysis is, are there enough amount of these hotels or enough amount of the customers to help you make a lot of money? That I guess is pretty evident to a lot of us. There are tons of hotels in places like Ernakulam. So again, in market segmentation, you could also say that we could target majorly cities, okay, other than going into lower towns, like kind of less than completely urban regions. So yeah, again, are there enough number of them to help make a lot of money? So I believe all of you agree. All right, nice. So we're gonna be rich. Yes. Okay. So next comes revenue model. In revenue model, I have not mentioned one point here, which we'll be talking about first, okay? So the first point that we're gonna talk about is the expense of setting this up, okay? In case of setting up a, let's say that small device, our solution A and solution B, in case of solution A, setting up that small device, the device actually I discussed before this session, I actually discussed with the IoT like pro, and the dude said it would cost somewhere around 500 to actually set up that device and connect it to the mobile application via Wi-Fi hotspot. So if you are making for like a hotel, we'll require 20 of those. We can get, my guess is we could be able to get one module for about 300 or less by, you know, purchasing power, because we are purchasing in a bulk. So yeah, that is not pretty costly. So for one hotel, let's say one module cost about 300, and we are like gonna set up in 20 tables, that's 6,000 rupees, right? 6,000 rupees plus cost of the mobile application, that will be pretty much negligible. So let's say less than 10,000 rupees, we can actually set up the whole thing. And 10,000 for a busy restaurant, 10,000 rupees is not at all an expenditure if they're able to set up a pretty good setup like this, if we are able to give them the best service possible. And so in my opinion, I just told you the financial stuff. So do you think it's financially feasible? It'll be easier and cheaper if there is a weak code scan and then others order can be played chronologically without waiting for the waiters attendance. Yeah, actually, this is probably the solution that comes in the mobile, setting up a mobile or a QR code and then scanning and ordering from the application or the website thing. But then again, there are many middle class hotels who are not interested in removing waiters, because waiters are a part of the experience. And even in my case, every single time I go to a hotel, I do like ordering new stuff. And before ordering anything new, I'll ask the person, okay, what's in this? What do you think about this? What is your suggestion? I almost always ask the waiter about their suggestion from their own products. Most of them are actually honest. They'll tell you which of this stuff actually goes more. And in many cases, I've got really good reply, as in the food that I ordered was pretty good. So yeah, I am a person who personally likes these, experience very much. I really like these experience of this interaction really well. And many hotel owners also think that this interaction is really valuable. So I'm not sure if they'll be willing to sacrifice that for making the process faster for the users. So that is one concern. I'm not saying your solution is wrong. Your solution is a solution that I actually implemented as a project in 12th grade. So for our all of you know that we have a project in CBSE. So that was a solution I implemented, but it did not. I don't really think that's the best. Okay. And so we know that the now we finalized that the solution A is feasible, solution B is kind of less feasible, but still a possible solution for us. And what else? So in case of revenue model, the next thing we need to think of is how would you make money out of this idea. First, you guys can just randomly say, how do you plan to make money out of this idea? Just randomly send your own answers. There is no wrong answer, just send your own answers. Installation and maintenance. Okay, nice. That was option number A. That was the option A I had in mind. We'll sell them the product, and in installation, we'll buy an amount from amount from them. We'll bill them a certain amount, and then like 6 months or 1 year maintenance, we'll take a certain charge from them. With and without installation, make packages. Okay. Rinalini's opinion actually goes well with my opinion as well. Charging a very small amount on orders. Okay, that is a possible case, but I'm not sure if the restaurant owners will agree to that, because they'll be if you're charging a very small amount on orders too, I don't think we can have a claim to their service, claim to the amount that they receive from their service for setting up this platform. Subscription model, installation, zero installation fee. Okay, that was option number two. Okay, so option number one is while installing, we'll give them a certain amount, we'll ask them to pay a certain amount. And after that, we'll ask them to pay for maintenance, whenever the maintenance is required, we'll ask them to pay an amount. So for every sale, we do make money. Okay, so, and the second one, is on installation, we won't give them a billing. Instead, we'll give it to them for free for like the first month. And if they like it, they can continue to use it for the following months. And every end of every month or beginning of every 6 months, they can pay us and for the continual use of their use of the product. And once they feel like they don't need it, they can just stop it and we'll take the system away from them. And since this is all wireless connections, we don't have any cost in installation and removal. So that'll be fine for us too. And guys, I just mentioned option A and option B, right? Option A is installation fee plus maintenance fee. And option B is a freemium based subscription model where initially we won't charge them anything, but after the first month, if they want to continue, they can pay for the rest of the months continually and they can just stop anytime they want. In the first one, there is a liability. Even if they stop, we still keep the money. In the second one, there is no liability. When they stop, they can stop. Okay. And the subscription fee will be continually really small for them to not have much of an issue with it. So what do you think? A or B? Which one do you like? Each of you like the most? Just send A or B. 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 Okay. Others? B. Okay. Nice. Nice. So yeah, my view is we might have to actually do both, because for most businesses owned by people who have been on the field for a really long time and all, they might not be really interested in subscription model because it seems a bit new to them, and they'll be more interested in just buying the product like they have been doing with every single other product that's purchased in their business for all this time. So I believe we might have to do both. We can pitch both to the both to the restaurant, and in my opinion, B is actually more feasible for the restaurant owner, and the restaurant can just pick either as per their wish. So that is, I think we might have to go with both. But then again, as you guys said, B seems to be really interesting one, really good approach. So now we have a problem. We had a problem. We solved it with the solution. We had two solutions. We analyzed the market and saw that the market was feasible for both the solution. But revenue-wise, we realized that the expense is much less for one of the solution. And we went with one solution. And we realized that the revenue model is also seems to be feasible for both the solutions. Okay. In other words, we just created a business. So yeah, congratulations, everyone. Let's make money. That is pretty much it for this one. What's next? Okay, yeah, this is the question. So far that you have heard about this, I want you guys to honestly tell me, are you really interested? Like, don't worry, I won't continue this session. My time is over. I'll be ending soon enough. Really soon. Oh, my time is over by about 15 minutes. Like 15 minutes. I'm sorry. So I'll be ending it soon enough. Just let me know, are you interested? How many of you here think that they are interested to learn when I want more resources? Nice. So I'll just let you know about a few resources. First one, I'll just mention the interesting resources and fun resources that you can actually use. Okay. First one, I'll mention a couple of YouTube channels. First one is Y Combinator. Y Combinator is a startup accelerator. In my opinion, that YouTube channel is a treasure chest of knowledge for people who are interested in startups. Okay. Then there is Slidebean and the last one, ThinkSchool. They basically do a lot of company forensics, company case studies, and all. It's really interesting. Dream It Ventures is also focused for startup owners and startup founders. But and those who are not really going into startup right now, just want to explore the field, I would suggest you to go for Slidebean and ThinkSchool channel. Okay. Then if anyone here actually listens to podcasts, Startup Therapy podcast and Entree Leadership podcast are two podcasts that I constantly listen to almost all the time when I go out. If I'm traveling alone in a car, I'll probably be switching on these podcasts instead of music, because trust me, it's really fun to just listen to all this. And Startup Therapy is pretty funny too at times. And in case of books, again, I'm really sure that most of you guys won't really take time to read the books, but still, I would totally recommend you guys to try out these three books at least. First one is 0-1 by Peter Thiel. I've read this book. This is so awesome. Peter Thiel was a co-founder of PayPal, and he has worked along with Elon Musk, one of the major investors in SpaceX and Facebook and all. And then Lean Startup is a book that I haven't read yet, but almost like about four people have been forcing me to read that book. And I've read that the book is so good with respect to startup knowledge. So those who are actually starting out in that field, I would recommend that book. And How to Win Friends and Influence People. Even if you're not going to get into entrepreneurship at all, this is a book about communication mostly and understanding other people. This will be really nice for you to understand how your customer thinks. So customer, your investor, whoever it may be, it'll be really nice and helpful. So How to Win Friends and Influence People. Okay, note that down. And in case of YouTube channels, I'll send you a document soon right now. And all of you will have access to that document. You can check out I've mentioned all the links there. And last one, this is something that's exclusively available to all MECNs. So make best use out of it. This is probably the most interesting of all these things I've mentioned as far. Unravel is basically a special interest group discussion. Okay. Discussion among a couple of people like us, where the SIG team will talk about some company. Like they've talked about Flipkart, Paytm, PayPal, etc. And they'll talk about the company, go into details about that. And you guys can ask questions. You can have the discussion going on. And trust me, it is really fun. Okay. So do take part in Unravel sessions or SIG sessions. It's hosted by IDC MEC. And this 19th December, actually this Sunday, we'll be having they'll be hosting a SIG on, I heard that they'll be hosting an SIG on Netflix. And I'm most probably, I'll also be there, obviously. So if you guys are really interested, do join in. Do make use of Unravel. So yeah, remember the image that I asked you to think of? The reason I asked you to think of that image is at any point in the cycle, you can actually split off into building a startup. At any point, if you get inspired into going into it, or if you want to solve a problem, the thing about building a company or moving into entrepreneurship is there are ways in which you can actually get into this at any point in your life. As in right now, from your college itself, you can start working in that direction. I'm personally working in that direction currently from college. The event managing head with us, Aditya, is also working in that direction right now. And then, or down the lane, once you have the right here, once you have a placement and say secure job, you can start exploring in that direction. And or even after that, after your like what you say, if you are in a really good position in a company, you can start if you have a dream, let's say problem you want to solve, you can move in that direction as well. So at any point, you can branch out into entrepreneurship if you put the time and effort and the interest into it. And most people actually branch out from this position, like promotions, and people like Bill Gates, Mark Zuckerberg, etc. actually branched out from the good college part. They branched out from right here. So you don't really have to be from a good college. I just took the copy paste from the first slide. That's why. So yeah, I guess you guys get the get what I was trying to mention. And so yeah, finally, I want to ask one last question. Right now, how many of you here really want to explore entrepreneurship at least once in any point? Like as I mentioned, you could start off at any point you want. So at any point, is there anyone who feels that you would like to branch out into this and solve your problems, create opportunities and make money? Mention in the chat that you do. Thank you. Amazing. So I really hope you guys do. And in my opinion, again, if you guys are actually trying to, what do you say, venture out into this or learn, explore about this while you're in college, IDC MEC is the best resource you can utilize. And every single people in IDC MEC actually working to help you guys in this direction as well. So do your best, feel free to contact them and us anytime you want, okay? So guys, thank you so much for your time. And yeah, the mandatory meme page, I'm out.